Howdy, friends. This is the Magic City Motormouth Fast Eddie Lane with your invitation to join yours truly, along with Mark Mabo Bowman and the Oracle of Ominous, the Wicked Nemesis, every Sunday night, 6:30 p.m. Eastern, 3:30 p.m. Pacific, for Beyond Ringside Live. Wrestling, mixed martial arts, sports talk, and a whole lot more. Keep your eyes open on BeyondRingside.com for all of upcoming show information, and of course, catch us on social media as well. Until then, we'll see you this Sunday, 6:30 Eastern, for Beyond Ringside Live on the Beyond Ringside Radio Network.
This is Dale the Demon Torborg.
My name is Bryce Rensburg. I'm the Chikara Senior Official.
This is April Hunter from AprilHunter.com.
I'm Bobby Chez, the three-time world champion, Showtime expert analyst.
This is Coolio with the Flow, a.k.a. the Ghetto Gourmet.
This is Dan the Beast Severn, the only Triple Crown champion in the UFC history.
Hi, everybody. This is Jerry the King Lawler. That's right. WWE Hall of Famer.
This is Jeff Damon from Deadliest Warrior on Spike TV.
You have tuned in. I'm NWA Heavyweight Champion of the World, Scrap Iron Adam Pearce. And just like you, I am also locked in. And brother, we are beyond ringside.
Welcome to the original rock and wrestling radio show. Welcome to Beyond Ringside, your source for wrestling, MMA, and boxing in the Southeast. To contact the Ringside Roundtable of Beyond Ringside, email them at beyondringside@gmail.com. And now, your host for Beyond Ringside, the man, no myth, all legend, Fast Eddie Lane.
And into everyone's life, a little rain must fall. And I know I've used that for the opening line before, but you know something? It fits, including blinking power in Studio One. Taking the risk, ready to have a little fun, 20 minutes before the top of the 6 o'clock hour in the Central Time Zone on this 10th day of July. Yours truly, the Magic City Motormouth Fast Eddie Lane, welcoming in tag team partner, the one, the only, the incomparable, Mark Mabo Bowman. What's up, brother? And for those of you who thought that he was going to make a poop reference there, he didn't. He went for the Phineas and Ferb shot. Thank you to everybody listening in this afternoon through BeyondRingside.com, the Beyond Ringside radio app for Amazon, Android, and BlackBerry. We have brand new sources that are now available online for everybody to listen. We are now a part of RadioShaker.com. Just recently signed the deal with them and very happy to have done so. Also, from that vantage point, we are now on with Radio Tower and their mobile app as well. So a number of different ways. Also picked up Streama, Streema.com, and their app. So a number of different ways everybody can listen. Of course, through ProWrestlingRadio.net, our TuneIn radio station. Of course, replays available all over the creation. That's the easy way to say it. Folks, tell you what, going to kick things off with the 800-pound gorilla in the room. And Mabo, I know you probably did not get a chance to see it last night. And I am talking about first time 5 years, Brock Lesnar inside the octagon for the Ultimate Fighting Championship and looked really good against Mark Hunt, Super Samoan last night. I caught the pay-per-view. Lesnar, I mean, I was impressed. First round, especially coming out of the blocks, 3 takedowns on Hunt in the first round and just a great effort. Just really kind of took Hunt off guard in the first one. But have you had a chance to read some of the reports or see some of the video coming out of it?
No, don't care. Unless it has the words Ronda and or Rousey in them, don't care.
That means you also missed the Miesha Tate Amanda Nunes fight.
Don't care.
I don't know. Cupcake.
Did Randy Orton come out like at the end of the match and RKO Brock Lesnar?
No.
Did he, you know, when Brock was down at any point, did Orton slither in and punt kick him in the head?
No.
Then don't care. Did Ronda Rousey come out in a bikini?
No, but I do have the pictures of her from the ESP and the bodies issue.
Yeah, I've got that too. But you know what? She wasn't there. Don't care.
Then indulge me for a second, because I'm going to sit back and say this. I will be totally honest with everybody. I predicted Hunt would win in the second round. And the way Hunt was like, getting some certain strikes in that second round, I thought it was going to come to fruition. I figured Lesnar would do what he would do in the early part of the first round, and that would be to try to establish distance to where he could see where he could come in for a takedown. I thought Hunt would be able to defend the takedown better. I didn't count on Brock getting three in that first round. I'm sitting here watching the screen going, whoa. And then Hunt decidedly had the second round. There was no doubt in my mind about that. But by the same token, Lesnar came back in the third round and just did it all over again. The takedowns, ground and pound. He looked really crisp. He looked really good. And I love what he said immediately following to Joe Rogan. He said, hey, let's take this one day at a time. I've also got to sit back. And one of the first things out of my mouth when the decision was read by Bruce Buffer, ain't no way in hell that Brock's going to do the J-O-B to Randy come SummerSlam. Which, of course, thank you to Jonathan Coachman of ESPN for emphasizing that on three different occasions during ESPN's post-fight coverage of UFC 200. He mentioned that more times than he mentioned the factor that Miesha Tate got her nose busted open. But let's go ahead and take it from UFC 200. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that probably Tuesday night on Back to Basics. Because there's a lot to cover from coming out of last night, both on the pre-show and the main pay-per-view. Money well spent. That's all I can say. But coming over to it, let's take a look at it a little bit further down the road, though. I know we still got Battleground coming up, but with the opponent for Lesnar being announced as Randy Orton, and then Lesnar having the performance that he did last night, how do you, Mark, seriously, how do you look at the possibilities for this match down the road?
For Orton Lesnar?
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I mean, you kind of put yourself in a pickle there if you want to keep, you know, no pun intended, but Brock keep him as a beast. But you can't just bring Orton back and then, you know, just to get him, you know, is he going to get squashed immediately? No. You know, I'm sure it'll be a highly competitive, lots of headlock rest holds that Orton's famous for. RKO, punt kick, snap, slam, rest hold. So,
reverse chin lock.
Oh, reverse chin lock, rest hold. That's it, Orton! But, I mean, he kind of, Kratos going to have to come up with something, because if not, they're going to paint themselves in a corner.
You've got enough people in, well, wait a minute, I can't say that anymore, because 1 week from tomorrow, the draft takes place.
Yep.
That number of expendable as the Horseman's Advocate, Andy Hudson, BR alumni would say, cannon fodder, that number gets cut drastically.
No. Hold on there, Senior Eduardo. They are looking to call up a butt ton of NXT. They're literally going to strip NXT bare from what I've heard, which is kind of good and bad because, you know, the good side, you know, a lot of deserving talent are going to get called up to the main roster. Bad side, you know, who knows what's going to happen with them.
Well,
good side, hold on. Good side down at NXT, it's going to get a lot of new faces some time to be on, you know, to get some exposure on the network. Bad side, some of those people that they're going to push don't really need to be on even the network. So, I mean, it's good, bad. Plus, you know, they're talking to, like, you know, other talent about coming back. So, you know, I mean, your fodder may be there.
Well, then let me throw...
Eddie, it is your fodder.
Andy Hudson, it is your cannon fodder. But I have to throw this one out there also. With all of the back and forth and all the speculations that's been put out on the internet, you know, you have so many people saying, no, it's not going to happen. No, it's not going to happen. No, it's not going to happen. But the principals involved aren't saying it's not going to happen. Kurt Angle, do we ever see him back in WWE?
Do we? I'm going to say, yeah. Is it going to be for, when we see him? I think it's going to be a...
Well, I'm just sitting here on a tip of Caturday. This is your man, the myth, the legend, the ginger with the beard, Gary J. And I just realized it's almost the end of the month. And you know what that means. Rent is due. And I have to pay rent because I want to respect my craft because you are locked in to Beyond Ringside.
just like that, we're back in the saddle. Mabo, do you remember where you were?
I was laying in my bed.
Where you were as far as your statement went.
The lights went out.
Boom, boom, out go the lights. Continuing on, angle.
I think a guy dressed as a bunny rabbit is a horrible angle. That's good. Let's see, where was that? Oh, yeah, something about, I can see like a sting type thing where it comes in, but, you know, maybe a little bit longer. I mean, like, I know Sting did Mania. Did he wrestle any other pay-per-view?
Yeah, remember, because he challenged for the belt.
Oh, yeah, but that was after Mania, though, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, but that was like, what, two, you know. I could see Angle maybe doing a six-month thing, but it'll be a little bit more ring active. By the way, if I cough, I can't cover up the phone because I don't know how to cover up an iPhone. But, I could definitely see Angle coming back and, you know, leading to a, you know, leading to the Hall of Fame and then maybe one big match. Who knows? Maybe a rematch against Brock? And hopefully Brock won't be stupid enough to go for a shooting star. Or at WrestleMania. Or, you know, if they can swing it around. I mean, they'd probably have to start about now. But maybe a little bit later. Don't mention that to be 6 months. But I would like to see Angle, you know, compete against multiple of the up-and-comers. You know, definitely Rollins. Let's see. Who else would Angle be a good fit against? Currently on the roster. I mean, you could always do Angle Cena again.
Of course.
Huh?
Of course.
Yeah, but like, who are some of the more up-and-cover guys that he would fit good with? Ziggler? I mean, and Angle Ziggler, you know, both being amateur wrestlers.
Both of them being healthy would be a beautiful thing.
Who's that?
Both of them healthy would be a beautiful thing.
Who, Ziggler and Angle?
Yeah.
Well, Ziggler's fine. I wouldn't mind seeing a little confrontation between Angle and Swagger. You know, about the whole Angle ankle lock thing. But then, you know, have, you know, maybe culminate it all, if not Angle Brock at WrestleMania, you know, with a Hall of Fame induction. Maybe if Takers decides to do one more, you know, maybe a Taker Angle. And then that's how Angle goes up.
Stumbled across. Go ahead. Huh? Go ahead.
What? Did Angle ever get to wrestle Randy?
I don't remember.
Yeah, I don't either. I mean, that would be an interesting one, too. So, I mean, yeah, I think it would be good to see him back in there if utilized properly, kind of, you know, pass the torch and then... give him a big send-off at Mania with a Hall of Fame induction.
Therein lies a question that I've asked myself on a couple of occasions because I've had discussions. I think you and I have discussed it. The S.S. Schmidtke and I have discussed it. A number of the folks here on the station have gone around and around about it. Would it be genuinely beneficial for... would it be beneficial to either or any of the parties if Kurt Angle aligned himself with American Alpha?
I could definitely see that, but you know they're gonna have to be on the main roster, obviously.
By whose logic?
Sorry, I had to take a drink there.
There you go.
I think it would just be well. First of all, they're really considering the idea of calling them up anyway.
Right.
So you know what a better way. But I mean, if you've got Angle, you're gonna want him on your main television product. And I mean, what would. Who wouldn't want to see Angle Joe again, this time done WWE style. Even Angle Aries.
This is where I've got a counterpoint on this one because there have been times where there were some that we thought would go straight to the main roster and they go through NXT first. I mean, Joe's a natural fit for the main roster, and even after the split, I think he'd be great on Raw. I'm not quite sure about the chemistry on SmackDown, but by the same token, I'm going off of previous days. With Joe going, with Aries on NXT, with Nakamura on NXT, Kenta, Hideo Itami went to NXT.
But honestly, I would keep. I would keep Joe on NXT. I would keep Aries on NXT. Nakamura. See, when you go to Hideo Itami and Nakamura, now Nakamura's definitely got, you know, 1,000 times more charisma than Hideo Itami.
Well, yeah.
So I could maybe see Nakamura getting a little silly, getting a little funny on Raw.
SmackDown.
I see him on Raw.
Okay.
I just think his outfit, you know, blends well. If he wears the outfit on SmackDown, it's going to clash. just aesthetics, you know.
Yeah, I loved it from one of the four New Japan shows that aired this week on Access.
Oh, my God. It was more than, I mean, between this week and last week, I know just in the last 2 days alone, I think I've got 3 or 4 of them banked that I got to get to.
Yeah.
But,
well,
yeah,
one of them's a replay.
The first part of the week had a good 2 or 3 of them.
Yeah, one of the later ones that is that I've got banked on the DVR is actually the replay of Nakamura Tanahashi, G1.
Yeah, I watched that. It was really good.
Oh, that was a beautiful match.
Oh, it was wonderful.
And just when I really get tickled. And I've actually drawn some heat privately for making the comment that I made about JR and Josh.
Who gave you heat?
It's behind the scenes. I'm not going to talk about it on air. I'm just going to say this. I've made the comment that even though it is in another language, I think it would be nice to go ahead and let the ring announcer do his thing.
Well, I'm going to say, whoever has a problem with what you said, could kiss my black ass, because Jim Ross, old Muppet Mouth, slobbering, watermelon head, don't know what he's talking about, geriatric piece of crap, get over himself, you know, just barbecue, just done with him, don't care. If anybody's got a problem with him, you message me, I don't care. And Josh Barnett has all the charisma and ability to be a good color guy is about as much as a used toilet paper tissue tube. So we know what I do with those.
There you go.
So, I mean, you know, whoever said that,
you had
my dank chicky nuggies.
You had a whole new dimension to recycling when it comes to that subject. But from there, no, I mean, here's the thing. And this is something that's always been a pet peeve of mine. So, folks, bear with me for a minute. When you have a broadcast that is taped or live, it does not matter. Everything adds to the nuances of the presentation. And even if it's taped from a damn year ago, remember, G1 Climax last year was August of last year. And from there, I think it is respect for the product for your play-by-play or your commentary team to shut up for a few seconds and let the ring announcer do the deal, because it adds to the effect of the match itself, even if it is 11 months old. My problem with the commentary for New Japan on Access is Ross and Barnett do not shut up. They actually did on the first introduction for Nakamura, but they didn't do it for Tanahashi. Or vice versa, one of the two. And that's just a me thing. I mean, when you have, granted, your announce team, which your announce team is also, your commentary team is also made up of your ring announcer as well. You think that Joe Rogan and Mike Goldberg talk over Bruce Buffer? No. Do you think Cole, JBL, Byron, Mauro Ranallo, do you think they talk over Lillian Garcia, Tony Chimel, or JoJo, or whoever's doing the ring announce? No.
Didn't happen on NXT, didn't happen in WCW, didn't happen in ECW. I mean, pretty much, for as long as I can remember watching televised pro wrestling, you don't talk over the ring announcer. I mean, it just makes perfect sense.
I mean, you give the match its due in that regard.
Yeah, I mean, they don't sit there and bust out, you know, ring announcing in the middle of you doing commentary, so, you know, why disrespect? I mean, to me, that's never disrespectful. And I don't care if, you know, oh, JR's been in the business for this long. I don't
care. Who cares?
He should know better.
Yeah. It's a respect thing. Respect the product enough to let all facets of it shine through.
not even respect the product, respect the guys. I mean, you got to think about this. A lot of these, you know, this could be someone's first time watching New Japan, you know, they for however they got into it. And so they might not be familiar with some of these guys. Yes, I know it's a year apart, but still. You know, it could be just, you know, like a lot of people just go to their DVR, punch in wrestling, and boom, it shows up. Be like, oh, well, this is Japanese wrestling. I've heard of it. Let me see what it's like. And if they can't understand, you know, who the guys are, you know, fully, or, you know, get the idea during full ring introductions, you know, yeah, you might say their names, but, you know, maybe they want to know who they are so they can Google them, look them up, figure out, maybe go YouTube them, check out some of their matches. Who knows? Maybe they can, you know, discover, you know, this will lead to, say, you know, finding Shinsuke Nakamura on NXT. Someone will be like, oh, you know, they might not know about him being on NXT, but they'll see this, and they'll be like, oh, well, let me find out what he's up to these days. What? He's on NXT on the network? Well, let me put down my $9.99 and see him on NXT.
Or vice versa. You could be watching NXT and catch Nakamura there, and it's like, wait a minute, somebody mentioned something about New Japan. Where's New Japan on my cable lineup?
Yeah, and then, you know, you're trying to learn all these new guys' names and stuff, and let's be honest, if you're, you know, you speak English and you don't really have much, you know, fluency in Japan and Japanese, you're going to want to know what these are. You want to know, you know, who's coming out with the Bullet Club or who's coming out with this group and that group. You might not, you know, catch that Gato is coming out with Okada or something like that. So you're wondering, who's that little guy with him? What's he doing? Who is that? So, yeah, just have some respect.
It's just, it's, like I said, it's the little things. For me, it's the little things in life that mean the most. And respecting all facets of the product is a great thing. I'm really glad, you know, taking a scan through Ring of Honor from this week. And I feel like I'm having a flashback because I'm trying to remember if this was originally part of, no, they were two different years. Jason Kincaid versus Donovan Dijak this week. And the Gift is, in my opinion, a very versatile competitor. I was segueing for a hot second from New Japan over to Ring of Honor. But, of course, Ring of Honor does that all the time. We're going to segue from Ring of Honor to New Japan. It's Ring of Honor. But, lo and behold, the thing about it is, when you've got such great talent, and there's some that I actually can see on the Ring of Honor product right now that would be good fits down at NXT. And this is the weird part about it. The chemistry that I see in NXT quite often is almost a parallel to what Ring of Honor has been doing the last couple of years on Sinclair. You see where I'm going with that? As Mark works his cough button.
Work it, baby. Work it.
There you go. No, but you see what I mean, right? About, okay, the production value is a little bit different, but the overall feel of the show, NXT and Ring of Honor are side by side in my book.
Yeah, I think NXT is a little bit more ahead, a little bit more. I don't know, because there just seems times where on Ring of Honor, things seem maybe a little choppy or a little, not so much forced, but maybe shoehorned.
Okay.
So, for example, like, I don't know, just might have been me, but the fish tank from this week, little odd.
Unfortunately, I have not had a chance to make it all the way through.
Okay, all right.
No, but feel free, go ahead, I'm good.
No, but I thought it was, well, no, yeah, it did take pride of place for like the middle of the show. But yeah, just, you know, it's a little odd. A little odd. I'll save it for people who may not have caught it yet. You know, don't want to drop any spoilers there.
No, feel free. Go ahead.
It's not just for you, fool. Maybe it's for the people who are listening.
I'm sure they won't mind either.
You don't know that, hush. But it was also kind of, it was very weird to see the bad addiction fluence, whatever they are. By the way, didn't know they won the belts. But, yeah, they came, you know, Kazarian Dales came out with the belts. And I was like, oh, well, I guess they beat War Machine or whatever, War Beard Row.
War Machine.
Bearded guys. But it was just weird seeing they took on Silas Young and the Beer City Bruiser. And it's just weird seeing them all shake hands. They, like, all upheld the code of honor. It was like, oh, that's weird. But yeah, no, it's just kind of, I don't know. It's just sometimes it's the, maybe it's the, I don't know. It just seems weird, like Jay Lethal shilling for knee braces and, you know. The way they do drop-ins sometimes.
Right.
You think it's going to maybe like a vignette or a promo and they're pushing merchandise. And then you have the, you know, the exotic goddess, Amanda Leone. She'll just pop in out of nowhere for some kind of update. So, I don't know. It's just, I think they could streamline their stuff a little bit. You know? You streamline it just a little bit.
At times, I can agree with that.
Smooth it out, you know.
Folks, tell you what, we're going to go to the top of the hour break. Hang tight with us real quick. We'll be back. This is Beyond Ringside Live on the Beyond Ringside Radio Network.
Sandwiches.
The To Be Determined Show live Wednesday nights, 9 Central Standard Time. Join myself, the Orc of Ominous, the Wicked Nemesis, the Grand Design, Clyde Braddock, and the Magic City Monroe, Fast Eddie Lane, as we take you to the edge of uncensored. Yes, we go uncensored, so make sure you have your earmuffs. Ask your parents, for those of you, you know, that are a little young, maybe under 18, but make sure if you have any heart conditions or any mental defects, please listen, because they may take effect right here live every Wednesday night, 9 Central Standard Time. Beyond Ringside Radio Network, beyondringside.com.
This is Dr. Tom Pritchard, and if you want to listen to the best in professional wrestling, get locked in to Beyond Ringside.
What's up, everybody? It's Stan Grubb for Corner to Corner Wrestling Radio and the Beyond Ringside Radio Network. Hey, join us every Sunday night at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time as the triple threat of wrestling radio goes live every week, giving you their thoughts and opinions on the world of professional wrestling. Myself, Brian, and Rob, all live, all here for you. And as my good friend Rob would say, from corner to corner and pillar to post, we bring it to you every week at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. BeyondRingside.com and ProWrestlingRadio.net.
Hello, everybody out there. This is Universal Soldier Phil Shatter, also TNA Gunner. 2 years in the making as NWA National Heavyweight Champion, making my way to the top as number one in the world. And you are locked in to Beyond Ringside.
Sunday nights at 11 p.m. Eastern here on BeyondRingside.com. Join us for the Midnight Black Mass. Myself, the Reverend Dan Wilson, brings you the dark gospel of professional wrestling, uncensored, unedited, uncut, and not for the faint of heart. You can find out more about us at youtube.com/pottyhumor or subscribe at Potty Humor on iTunes and Stitcher today.
This is Jim Cornette. You are locked into the show of all time, Beyond Ringside.
Howdy, friends. This is the Magic City Motor Mouth, Fast Eddie Lane, with your invitation to join yours truly, along with Mark Mabo Bowman and the Oracle of Ominous, the Wicked Nemesis, every Sunday night, 6:30 p.m. Eastern, 3:30 p.m. Pacific, for Beyond Ringside Live. Wrestling, mixed martial arts, sports talk, and a whole lot more. Keep your eyes open on BeyondRingside.com for all of upcoming show information. And, of course, catch us on social media as well. Until then, we'll see you this Sunday, 6:30 Eastern, for Beyond Ringside Live on the Beyond Ringside Radio Network.
This is Bambi Weevil with Masters of Ring Entertainment, and you are locked in to Beyond Ringside.
The war is war! And you are locked into Beyond Ringside.
Oh, yes! This is Paul Bearer! And some people call me Percy Pringle III. You're locked in to Beyond Ringside.
Set and ready to go? You got us. Round two, Beyond Ringside Live. Fast Steady Lane over here, welcoming back Mark Mabo Bowman.
Oy vey.
You're having power outage troubles over at the house, aren't you?
No. Just regular old crappy charter equipment failure.
I have to go back and I'm going to go ahead and correct something real quick because I had a feeling it was before Best in the World. I just wasn't sure. And it was actually back in May 9th to be exact, when the Addiction won the ROH Tag Team Championships. I didn't think it was that far back, and that's my fault, folks, and I apologize for that. But by the same token, when they've got everything in play, Ring of Honor has been, I'm not going to put anything on Ring of Honor in this particular regard, because I think that, you know, there's times when they will run 4 weeks from a certain show and it throws off the timing and you don't always get a chance. And I know it sounds like I'm putting it back on Ring of Honor, but unfortunately that's the way it sounds. But you know, when you work as much as I do and you try to keep track of everything, and the time space continuum just screws with you on a regular basis, like it does me. But what the hell was that rolling blockbuster out of the corner that looked like it went horribly wrong? It looked like he was trying to go for the sunset flip victory roll blockbuster out of the corner. Talking about Jason Kincaid on Donovan Dijak.
Oh.
You okay?
No, it's okay.
Because it looked like Dijak just squared the top of his head on that roll through.
Donovan Dijak, like, for all intent purposes, should be, on a national scale somewhere. Like, I would say NXT, but for some reason, he's not. Do you know who should be? And I don't know why. I don't know what reputation he might have garnered. But Chris Dickinson. Catch him a lot on Beyond Wrestling. Infamous for the whole chucking Princess Kimberly across the ring, that whole thing.
Right.
That guy, you know, looks like he's been carved out of granite. I don't understand why he hasn't been given a chance. Oh, well. Sorry. Just a little ponderings.
No, dude, that's what the show is all about. What are you talking about? For everybody listening on the live side this evening, I do want to throw out there, the trifecta is back in full force. Corner to Corner Radio kicks off at 9 p.m. Eastern, 8 Central this evening. And, of course, a brand new edition of the Midnight Black Mass takes over at 11 p.m. Eastern, 10 p.m. on the Central side. And everybody on the West Coast, do the math. How you doing? Good to see you out there. I'm waving like an idiot, but I'm actually waving in the wrong direction because my studio is set up facing east, not west. But I will throw this one out there. Also slated for their next stop on the summer tour, Ring of Honor for Aftershock. In 5 days, it's going to be a tag team war in more ways than I can count. Because, lo and behold, you've got a situation where the Briscoes, the IWGP Tag Team Champions, will be defending, or I don't know if it's a title defense, but they'll be facing off against Silas Young and the Beer City Bruiser. If that does not have the potential to be one of the hardest hitting matches you will see on a Ring of Honor broadcast, I don't know what will. And this is the thing about it. There's no guarantee that this is going to be taped for television. This could be a straight for VOD DVD taping, if they even tape it at all. But honestly, as a tag team wrestling fan, as somebody who genuinely appreciates it for the art form that it is, I would kill to be 2300 Arena, Saturday night, July 16th, 6 p.m. bell time, to see this tag team match take place. What about you, brother?
No, I'm good.
God, there goes that phrase again.
Well, I mean, I'm going to Philadelphia. I'm going to go for two reasons.
One, Chikara.
One, Chikara. Or two, having the show last night, Excellence Pro.
Hmm.
Are you the only reason why I'd go up to the Pennsylvania area?
Three, Grand Slam.
Nah, I'm good.
Four, Combat Zone.
Hell no.
You have your taste. I have mine.
Hell no, man.
And speaking of, this coming Saturday night, ROH World Championship, Jay Lethal versus Colt Cabana. Tag Team Championship, Triple Threat Match, The Addiction versus the MCMG versus War Machine.
Versus who?
The Addiction versus Motor City Machine Guns versus War Machine.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I didn't hear the letters. It kind of got a little crackly there.
It's okay. Donovan Dijak taking on Leo Rush in what could be an awesome matchup. Hangman Page versus Dalton Castle, which should be an excellent one-on-one matchup.
Who versus Dalton Castle?
Hangman Page.
Oh, is that what he called himself again?
Yeah.
I guess if you're in the same group as Adam Cole and you're the lesser guy, you gotta change your name.
Didn't we see that happen one time before in Impact Wrestling when you had, what's her name? Texas girl, butt implants, one that I never really got into. Brooke.
Lexi von Erich?
No, Tess Mocker, that's what it was. The former Hooter girl. Brooke Tess Mocker, and then Brooke Hogan came on board, so she just had to take her name back to Miss Tess Mocker. It's like, really? You've got to change. Yeah. You've got to drop your first name to accommodate Hogan's little trollop.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sucks.
His air quote daughter. When the late Lance Cade, when he signed on, he had to change his name to Garrison Cade because they had a Lance Storm.
True.
Rocco Rock just had to be Rocco because he already had Rock. Shane Helms, while he had 25 being the Hurricane.
More musical intros today than I've got active brain cells. There, I finally said it. And lo and behold, when everything comes together and falls apart at the same time.
Maybe okay, let's see if the cell phone will go out again for no reason.
There you go.
Are we back on the air?
Yes.
All right, let's hurry up and do this show before something really bad happens.
Let's go ahead and take it for the next 9, and we'll sign out after that because I'm getting power blinks over here on the studio side also.
Okay.
Where were we?
I don't freaking know. We were making fun of people changing
name games. Name game. That's what it was.
Yeah.
By the way, also slated this Saturday night for Ring of Honor, Adam Cole, The Young Bucks, RPG Vice, Moose, Shane Taylor and Keith Lee, Caprice Coleman, The ANX, Jonathan Gresham, BJ Whitmer. In the Women of Honor, Mandy Leone, Sumi Sakai, Jenny Rose, Veda Scott. It's the Aftershock Tour at the 2300 Arena, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Door opens 4:30 Eastern Time, pre-show 5:45. Estimated bell time is going to be around 6 o'clock p.m. Tell you what, if you get a chance to, definitely check it out, folks. There are some great shows going on all around the world, all across the country. The calendar page is back on beyondringside.com. I want you to take down a couple of addresses, folks. BeyondRingside@gmail.com, Stamper@WrestleReality.com. Pro wrestling, mixed martial arts, boxing, sports promoters, send us your event info. We will put it on the .com in our calendar section, as well as on the Facebook sites. Not charging anything. If you want to send us a t-shirt or a picture, that's great. Pick somebody.
I'm charging.
What you charging?
A hug.
Kind of hard to do by email.
Not the way I do it.
There you go. I think that's what Tammy Sitt said also recently.
Yeah, she charges it.
Here's a funny one for you. Actually, a good one in my book, and I tip my hat. I'm going back over to the Lesnar conversation from earlier. Read the story that it was made public how much Brock Lesnar made last night. $2.5 million. That's according to Kevin Lowell over at Yahoo Sports. It's not only Lesnar's biggest UFC payday, but also the highest guarantee pay for any UFC fighter in history. Conor McGregor was previously guaranteed $1 million back in March for UFC 196. I almost have to wonder if part of the reason wasn't the fact McGregor didn't want to share the spotlight. He wanted to be the big dog, the big draw. And he couldn't be that with Lesnar on the card. Even the women in the main event, you know, good first round KO, but still by the same token, Lesnar was the star of the night. Most people, most everybody has agreed to that. But $2.5 million for one show. Nicely played, Brock. Not bad for technically 15. Yeah, you can never call it 15 minutes work because you've got the training camp and everything else that you're doing. So you can't just say 15 minutes. There's a buttload of work that goes into a camp getting ready for a single fight. You know, we make references to road trips, and I'm gonna have to pop the cork in your direction. Because
I don't have anything to wipe it up with.
I knew you were going to say that.
No, you didn't. You're just saying that to make yourself sound like you're smart.
Why would I want to lie like that?
It makes the girls go crazy.
Oh, okay. Since when do I care what other people think about me?
All the time.
Not really.
You're human, just like the rest of us.
There you go. Of course, I'm going to ask you, and I think you already know. The next two events for Jakara, you brought them up.
I did. Did I?
Yes, you did. Well, you brought up Jakara.
Yeah, I just had Jakara. They're going to be up in, like, Canada or something.
Yes. 432 yeah. Horner Avenue, Toronto, Ontario.
Toronto.
They have a double shot that day on July 23rd.
Oh, yeah.
Already featured for When Nature Calls. New battles, same demons. I love it. Dasher Hatfield, Drew Gulak, Kimberly, Heidi. Wow, hold on. I'm trying to figure that one out. Oh, okay. Kimberly, Heidi, and the Sea Stars versus the Hexed Men.
Yeah, that's going to be interesting. If you don't know who the Hexed Men are, that's pretty much all the guys that have become under the thrall of Nazz Muldoon. You know, it's obviously Halloween and Frightmare. Then they got the Bateri. Actually, then they got Ultra Mantis, but Ultra Mantis obviously was retired to wrestle. But then they got the Bateri. The Bateri brought, at some point, they snagged Icarus, too. If you want to know when, go to Chikaratopia, sign up for your free month, $7.99. Or sign up for your free week, and then roll over for $7.99 for, you know, your monthly subscription. But then they got Icarus. And which, once again, if you know your Chikara history, Icarus and Hallowicked, night shift, just saying. And then they got Kobold not too long ago. So, yep. I wouldn't be shocked if you see in King of Trios coming up, maybe, you know, the Bateri and Kobold, you know, for one team for Nazz Muldoon, and then Icarus, Frightmare, and Hallowicked and the other team.
Well, there will be a four-corner elimination tag team match as a part of this show. They have not, well, on their website, they don't have all four teams announced. However, I'm pretty sure they have it up on their social media sites. But also slated for that 2 o'clock outing, Oleg the Usurper versus Officer Warren Barksdale, as well as Kobold versus Evil Uno.
Yes, yes. At some point, Player Uno has become corrupted in Evil Uno, so you're going to see the new form of Kobold, the Giga Goblin, a form that has not been achieved in, I think, thousands of years, taking on the corrupted, now evil Uno, the former Player Uno. And if you want to see somebody who takes a video game gimmick to the extreme, go watch some Player Uno. Good stuff. Good stuff.
Yeah, I was having a field day earlier in the month when El Rey was actually doing a special monster-esque movie series and calling directly out of the Kaiju fame. And I'm sitting back going, that's a smile. And I wish I could have seen all the ones that were featured on that. Fourth of Kaiju Lie, I believe it was what it was called. It's amazing how things get twisted and turned around and everybody jumps on it in different ways. Also, later on that evening, on July the 23rd, Back in the Habit at the Franklin Horner Community Center in Toronto, Ontario. And this one's going to be a 7 p.m. outing. Hallowicked versus Fire Ant. Mabo, you want to take that one?
That should be for the Grand Championship, if I'm not mistaken.
I believe it might be.
Yeah, that's going to be, I mean, you know,
McCauley's always been a staple of Chikara, but Fire Ant is the staple of that staple. I mean, you know, at one point he had a very impressive solo career going on, so yeah, definitely that's gonna be one heck of a match. Can Hot Property Fire Ant up in Hell Wicked with the power of Nas Muldoon? I don't know. Since Hell Wicked went through that change, he's been a force to be reckoned with, that's for sure.
NRG taking on Mustache Mountain.
Yeah, coming back over from the UK. I think Fight Club Pro. It always escapes me who Mustache Mountain is. What group they're mainly affiliated with? But yeah, they are two gentlemen.
And what about for people who don't know quite who Race Jackson and Hype Rockwell are?
Oh, that's dead. That is NRG. I think actually they're still your current Campeones de Parejas. I don't think they lost the belts.
By the way,
they lost the belts.
Hmm.
I don't think they lost the belts.
You keep a little bit closer track to Chikara than I do.
I know, but I'm just sitting there thinking. I'm like, have they lost the belts? Heck, we didn't know that the Addiction had won, so.
Or remember when they won.
I remember when they won.
There you go.
I
will assume that they are, because according to ChikaraPro.com, they are still listed as champions.
Well, then, yes, they still are the champions.
Because they have Hello Wicked listed as the grand champion, NRG as the Campeones de Parejas, and I do believe Thunder Frog?
Yes, he is your current
Young Lions Cup.
Reigning and defending Young Lions Cup.
The Estonian Holder. Thunder Frog.
Huh?
Estonian Thunder Frog, isn't it?
He still speaks with the Estonian accent, but he might just be. At one point, he was super Estonian Thunder Frog, and he was super Thunder Frog. Since he came back from being Farmer Frog, I don't know.
Hmm.
Maybe they just don't like to label him. Maybe he's just, Thunder Frog.
Missile Assault Man taking on Pinky Sanchez on the 23rd.
See, this is where it's getting. Things are getting kind of odd with former members of the Battleborn and former members of PDK. And I know Worker Ant number two, used to be Assault Ant, Assail Ant. He's kind of been reaching out. Like, he reached out to Arctic Rescue Ant, and then, he's reached out to Pinky Sanchez, and he's not happy. We'll cover this in a second. That the colony, Silver, Fire, and Soldier, they're going to be competing at King of Trios, and he's a little upset that they didn't ask him, since Silver Ant, turned down the mantle of Worker Ant, and two, Worker Ant was the third original member and not, Green Silver, so he's a little kicked off. And, maybe we're going to see another colony. Who knows? But, you got Missile Assault Man, who used to be Missile Assault Ant, and you got Pinky Sanchez, who, years ago infiltrated the colony as Carpenter Ant and became Pink Ant with Brutus Chef. And then they're both act crap crazy.
Hmm.
So it's going to be interesting.
I've got to sit back and say it's been a while. Pinky Sanchez has actually been able to make a nice resurgence over the last probably, 8 months? Because there was a point in time where Sanchez kind of dropped off.
Maybe a little bit more of a year.
Okay. But I mean, not
doing a lot with Team Pazuzu, not just Chikara with the British Chef, but he was on Team Pazuzu up in Beyond Wrestling and a couple other places. So.
Right, but I mean, he had been, there was a point where I did not see his name out there with any promotion. So I knew
he had definitely stepped back a lot.
Mm-hmm. Because I remember, now, did you meet him before we met him up at IWA Deep South?
I never. I don't think I'd ever met him. Of course, I knew of him, but never met him, so.
There you go. Still like to get Pinky on the show sometime full scale.
I don't know about that.
So what?
That would be more of a to be determined show, kind of.
Do you think Wick wouldn't?
I'm just saying that would be, Pinky is probably more built for the to be determined show.
There you go. Also, real quick, final match we have listed for the 23rd, Lucas Calhoun versus Soldier Ant. Maybo?
That's going to be interesting. I like Lucas Calhoun. I would like to see him definitely, you know, who knows whatever's happened to Snowflake, Kevin Condren, or whatever. I don't know. I don't know. And honestly, I'm tired of him popping in and out. Just go ahead and just get rid of him. But, yeah, I like Lucas Calhoun. I mean, people are like, oh, he's a honky-tonk man ripoff. So? I don't care. I mean, you know, he's not as goofy or over the top as honky-tonk man was, so. But, yeah, I like me some Lucas Calhoun. The old juke joint, Lucas Calhoun, definitely like that. But while we're on the subject, I don't know, since you and I have last talked, I don't know if, you know, trios teams that you know of that have been added. You know, I know it started off, the first team was the Sendai Girls, and then Team Shimmer, Madison Eagles, Candice LeRae, and Crazy Mary Dobson. And I'm pretty sure I said something to you about Team Original Divas Revolution being Victoria, Nikki James, and Jazz. But they added Team JWP. Not going to try to pronounce those names. Not going to butcher the Japanese names.
Hanako Nakamori, Manami Katsu, and Kaman Bolshoi.
Yeah, well, you still sound like you butchered them. But, you know, Heidi Lovelace and Hype Rockwell and Race Jackson has been added. And I think it was one of the Bateri made the joke of, because up at that point it had been all women, you know, all three, you know, all teams have been all female. And, one of the Bateri, I think, made the joke of, well, looks like they're going to stick with the all-women team when they get to NRG and Heidi.
Yeah.
Basically saying they're girls. And then, of course, the Colony, like I touched on a minute ago. And then just announced this week, and this is kind of team I'm kind of pulling for there. Oleg Usurper, Princess Kimberly, and Thunder Frog.
You're just happy you finally got that 8x10 autograph from Kimberly in your bedroom.
I need another one. Kind of ruined it.
Don't say it.
Too late.
Don't.
it got some liquids on it. I need one that's lemonade.
I should have done that just to spite you, but I figured you'd get pissed if I did it.
No, if you'd lemonade, it'd make it so much easier.
Oh, God. I knew you'd get that reference in. And taking the
what reference? I see. There you go. Assuming everything. Assuming you always know. Guess what? You can assume you're wrong because you don't know what I'm talking about. I have guinea pig, and I'm constantly changing water bottles, and sometimes get a squeeze of freshness. There, you know, the water bottle squirts water. You know, I'm a messy eater. So you don't know. You don't know. So don't assume there, pickle puss.
Okay, Thunderbox.
All right, there, log drop.
Daryl B., how you doing tonight? Glad to see you over in the chat room. By the way, I was...
limey son of a...
That,
dusty...
Yeah.
Mother trucker.
It's okay. He why hates you too.
Why you always got to mention him? If he wants, you know what? If I want to hear him, his name mentioned on the show, then he needs to call in and be on the show. If not, you know what? He can Brexit just like the rest of his country did. He can Brexit off of this dadgum chat.
Dude, really?
No, not really. But
that's what I thought.
You know what? I'm tired of hearing Daryl B. I'm like, hi, Daryl B. You're in the chat. Daryl B.
Not to mention the fact of the references, the shout outs he gives us on Twitter. And I'm appreciative of those.
No, he doesn't.
He just said in the chat room, and I do hate Mabo too. So, ha, you're even.
Yeah, well, who's on the show and who's not? Oh,
That
you're
was...
a figment of Eddie's imagination.
Some people say that you're a figment of the imagination.
I'm a nightmare, apparently.
Well, there you go.
There you go.
By the way, I was a little bit late getting into the chat on Wednesday, and I went back and compared the timelines, and you were like one step ahead of me as far as the name of the menagerie, and I appreciate you putting that in there. We were having a discussion earlier in the week on TBD about some of the things going on in Impact Wrestling right now, and I was asked what my thoughts on Decay was, and Wick wanted to know a little bit more of the background on Crazy Steve, and I could not remember the menagerie to save my life.
How could you not remember the menagerie? It was him and Rebel.
I remembered the group. I couldn't remember the name of the group.
Oh.
I remember.
Yeah, Mike Knox and then The Freak.
Rebel. God Lover.
God bless it. You know, she's pretty to look at, but she's not Eva Marie bad.
Oh, she's far from that bad, dude.
She's not even really bad, but I would put her up there with early Kelly bad.
No, not even Kelly was early Kelly bad.
Maybe she's not good. She's maybe Lacey Von Erich bad.
She's not. Oh, God, no. Lacey Von Erich was worse than Eva Marie bad.
No, Lacey Von Erich was not that bad.
You're just saying that because she's blonde with big boobs.
Well, you know, there's a prophet Hogan's blonde with big boobs, but you don't seem to complain about him. But no, I mean, Eva Marie, I think just, can we talk about somebody else? Seriously, just stop for a second. Speaking of blonde with big boobs, it was horrible. Why is Dana Brooke still on the TV screen?
Because she's blonde with big boobs and creative wants her there.
She legit looks like a walking sex doll, first of all.
No, not even that good.
Most like sex dolls.
Okay, wait a second. Right. Daryl, who has improved a lot, to be fair? Continue, Bowman.
I was waiting for his answer.
Oh, okay.
But Dana Brooke is terrible. She's proven that. She messed up at the pay-per-view. She's messed up on just any time that she has to interfere, any time that she even has to take a punch, whatever. She just, no. Bad. Bad Dana Brooke.
Ah, okay. Daryl said Rebel.
Wait, then who's improved?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, that's like saying, hey, there's corn in this turd. It's still edible.
Oh, so, come on.
What? I'm just saying.
Okay. See, to me, Rebel wasn't that bad to begin with, and she did improve. She did manage to learn quite a bit, and...
I think with Rebel Wars, she was kind of... bland, maybe?
She was a little bit but see, she was also new to the televised side of it.
I think she was more, scratch that, I think she was more just there. I think maybe if they had, you know, I can't remember if at the time they still had their agreement with OVW.
Right.
I think they did.
No, because that's when Taylor Hendricks left, and I thanked God. Speaking of Dana Brooke / Eva Marie bad.
Yeah.
And I
want to know, seriously, did her mom have sex with like a hog-nosed snake? Because that's what's wrong with her nose, first of all. She's pale. Like, she's beyond pale. She is
Sheamus.
Like...
Sheamus pale.
Like past, no, she's not even Sheamus pale. She's like, if somebody stole white paint on Sheamus, that's how pale she is. Like, she's... Somebody should seriously check her vitals and make sure she's got, you know, blood in her, because she's horrible. I would rather watch Dana Brooke versus Lacey Von Erich versus Eva Marie versus a mop.
I was gonna say a department store mannequin.
Yeah. Then have to do anything with Taylor Hendricks. She's terrible.
You know the mannequin would go over, right?
Well, the mannequin would probably have the best personality.
No, you know the mannequin's going to work. The mannequin's going to work stiff anyway.
Mannequin, you know, mannequin definitely have more charisma.
More than likely, and probably more moves too.
Yeah, but I'm telling you, dude, if like the plan for them to make, you know, to give Dana Brooke the Roman Reigns push, if does come to fruition, then everything that Sasha and
Becky Natalia, and Paige,
Becky Lynch, Paige, AJ Lee. I'm not going to say the Bellas because they can sit there. We originated. We're the ones that started the Divas Revolution.
No, you're not.
No, you didn't. No, you didn't. You bubble headed, bubble boobed, granola crunching, Cena slurping, Daniel Bryan kissing, dirty hippie hooker. No, you didn't.
It took you a minute to get there.
Well, there's two of them, so. But no, you did not. So quit saying that. Go do your total Bellas and total stay over there.
I'm perfectly happy without them being on WWE television. I am perfectly content with them not being anywhere near a visibility range.
Yeah. Unless for some reason Dana Brooke does a complete, you know, like 180 and just becomes this super phenomenal pro wrestling chick or whatever. Before that happens, she's going to crap on everything. But as much as I don't like Charlotte, especially her face, she can't wrestle. Oh my God, speaking of what the crap, why is Summer Rae still allowed on TV? Why is Summer Rae still in the WWE? She dropped Becky's squat on her head. She messed up just about everything. Like, that happened, what, this past Monday, the Monday before?
Yeah.
Something like that? Yeah, it was already on the latest episode of Botchmania.
Already?
Yeah. Actually, he dropped two episodes. 313, 314. But yeah, definitely. Go check. If you can find it, because, you know, check out Botchmania. You know, it is funny to watch. But yes, like, because I had missed it. I had walked out of the room or turned my back or something. And then I heard somebody talk about it, and I went back, and I just saw it on Botchmania, where Summer Rae, I guess, went to do the suplex and dropped a petulance right on her head, just right there. And I'm like, oh my God, if you hurt my girlfriend, so help me.
Your girlfriend, my future ex-wife.
No, she. I'm keeping her.
I kick you in the way. I will kick you out of the way.
Well, you know, you'd have to get on the freaking steps to leave and look her in the eye there, Eddie. Calm down.
I do not give a damn. I'll go get a cherry picker and a crane.
I will cut that big bird looking hooker, Summer Rae. If she would have hurt Becky Lynch. I mean, first of all, sexy accent. Second of all, multiple colored hair with the orange and the red and the yellow and all that stuff. That's nothing. Plus, also, puns. She is the queen of puns in the locker room. So, I would run over Summer Rae with a dump truck.
See, therein lies the rub, because I've got to sit back and say they wasted opportunity at WrestleMania. Honestly, they did. They wasted the opportunity at WrestleMania, because I genuinely felt, and this is just me talking, let's go for this, that the logical thing to do. Now, I understand everybody, yep, that looked so nasty when Summer dropped or thought she was really hurt. Agreed. But from that vantage point, I got to throw this out there. I know that Flair politicked and everybody politicked to have Charlotte with a successful title defense on Mania. I felt that considering everything Charlotte had done, now I understand why they're going to keep the belt on her, because the vindictive cycle and the vicious circle continues. But after they kept the belt on Nikki long enough to eclipse AJ Lee, now with everything else going on, they're probably going to keep the belt on Charlotte long enough to eclipse Nikki. Okay, that's great, wonderful. That's doing the belt no justice. In my book, it's not. But if the first person that she drops the belt to is not Becky Lynch, something's wrong. I agree. Well, wait.
She's going to drop it to Sasha.
I'm okay with that to a degree. But I genuinely feel that the pecking order is screwed up in the women's division. That is why when they do have the draft, if they split up the title, okay, you can have the women's title and bring out the ladies' title. Yeah. don't bring back the Divas title, no matter what the hell you do, because I don't want another remembrance of that era when you had the majority of the women who were out there who were butts and breasts and no talent. Look, there's strip joints for that. I turn on a television show that revolves around sports entertainment, or I turn on a pro wrestling show, I want to see women who know how to work a match. That's me. Talent matters. The ability to convey psychology from bell to bell matters. The ability to physically work a match to where you do genuinely want to suspend disbelief and check it at the door matters. I mean, look, like I said, if I want to see curves, I go to the nudie bar. That's just me. I go daytime and nighttime. I don't avoid vampire strippers.
Hey, when you die one day, don't say anything. Well, okay. I'll just take you in the heart because you're one of the undead.
I will not be. Dude, I've been one of the undead for centuries. How long have I been? I'm a night owl.
Well, there's a difference.
Tell me. Yeah, sure.
Okay. Turn on you one day.
Okay. I understand that. One of the everybody turns on everybody one day.
Well, I'm just saying, when I have to stake you in my little tiny black heart when you become a vampire, if you're lucky, they might just drain you and eat you completely. They might have little snack Eddie bites or whatever, little Hot Pocket Eddies.
Hot Pocket Eddies. Oh, there you go.
By the way, have you seen the new, I know this is completely off subject, but it just made me think about the Hot Pocket. Have you seen that they're doing food truck Hot Pockets now?
No.
Yeah, they're doing they have them in bites. It's flavors. They have bites, and then they have the regular in the crusty sleeves or whatever they are. But yeah, they're basing kind of around food truck food. So, but enough of that. We'll discuss. Tune in on Beyond Refrigerator later on.
Beyond the Fridge Side?
Beyond Fridge Side. There we go.
There you go. We could do this.
Trademark that.
Yeah, calling Cabana Man Dan. He could join us for that one.
No, you don't call him Cabana Man Dan for that. Don't be ridiculous. And you call him the Bev Nerd. What's wrong with you?
Okay.
Kayfabe, man. Kayfabe.
It's all work anyway. Who cares? Everybody knows. Man. UFC's a work. Wrestling is real.
Yeah, KFC's a work, too. George spices my ass.
George, oh my God.
Oh, sorry, what?
The new Colonel Sanders, the extra crispy.
No, we're not
Colonel's.
Talking about those. We're not talking about those. Get back to wrestling. We're not talking about those. Those scare the hell out of me. We're not talking about those. Go back to wrestling. Go back to wrestling now.
I want Norm MacDonald back. I don't give a damn about Daryl Hamlin or any of the other ones, and I sure as hell don't care about the current guy.
No, we're not talking about. Nope.
I want Norm MacDonald back.
Royal Rumble.
That's not for another 6 months.
I don't care. That's
7 months?
That's what I'm looking at.
You're a hard
guy. Rock is winning at SummerSlam, and then her and Becky are going to have title match.
Wait, say that again?
Sasha is going to win the belt at SummerSlam, and then her and Becky are going to have a title match at Royal Rumble.
Do you think that it's going to make it to SummerSlam?
Yeah.
You just sound like a cat whose tail got set on by a rocking chair.
Well, I mean, they have their match at Battleground. Obviously, Dana Brooke's going to interfere, yada, yada, yada. Set up, I don't know, Dana Brooke on a pole. It wouldn't be the first time she sat on a pole. But, they'll do something to where, Dana Brooke is taken out of the equation. Maybe Paige shows up. I don't know. I miss Paige. I hate that she's dating Alberto Del Rio. That pisses me off. Anyway, it's going to go, maybe it'll be a cage match. Who knows? Sasha versus Charlotte in a cage. Dana Brooks, somebody deflated her or something. So, then that's how it's going to go down. I would see that. What do you think? Sasha, Charlotte in a cage, SummerSlam.
I have to do this because I'm going to lay this out there.
Because Daryl just, shut up. It's going to be a minute.
Because... Nope, Daryl laid it out in the chat room the same way that I've been saying it the whole damn time. Becky Lynch should have gotten the title at Mania because Sasha had the entrance with Snoop and the other Raven Phoenix or whatever the hell her name was. Charlotte had Rick at ringside. And you're right, Becky should have walked out with the belt. Because going back to the comment that Paige made going into all this about Becky being the least relevant out of the whole group, it would have been poetic for Becky Lynch to get the title at Mania. And then you could have started the round robin horse crap. That would have been fine.
Dude, I'm telling you, it's because they're building for Charlotte and Sasha at SummerSlam. You know, and then Sasha getting hurt or whatever happened and her being off a little bit kind of delayed things, but...
Yeah, I went back and watched Mania the other day, and I felt bad because the girl who was doing part of the vocals for that song was just off. I mean, and I understand, having worked in front of decent-sized crowds, I have never worked in front of a crowd that big, at least all in the same building. When you have a circumstance where you're coming around the corner and you're faced with 100,000 people, it's like, oh my God. I mean, I've worked in front of 17, 18,000 people before as an announcer and as a commentator, but there's just something I'm sure that just, I mean, when I did events in those environments and for mixed martial arts and for wrestling, on that scale, it's and had that opportunity. It's just I walk around the corner or walk out on down the ramp, and it's, oh my God,
people.
And so I can only imagine what the kid felt if she's never worked in front of a crowd half that size. But she was just off. And the saving grace for it all was Snoop was on it. Snoop will be on it 10 years after he passes. That's how much talent Snoop has. That's just me. But I agree. Becky should have gotten the belt at Mania. And then they could have gone ahead and gone round robin with the damn thing after that. But that's just me. I genuinely believe like that. You have something for everyone in a circumstance. And what they've done basically is take Paige's phrase and bring it into fruition. So far, Becky has become the least relevant out of the whole damn group. Even with Sasha having been injured. Maybe.
Well, actually, originally the whole thing with Natalya and Becky that's going on right now, the roles are actually supposed to be reversed. It was supposed to be Becky that, you know, turned on attacking Natalya. But like I said, I think we've talked about this before. But I think Natalya is she's getting ready to take a long hiatus.
It may be time
because Tyson's not coming back.
Mm-mm.
So I think she's maybe she's about to get ready to go spit out fifth generation fourth.
Hey, if they ever want to get a divorce, I'll be more than happy to come up there and move into the opening.
She's fun to look at, but she just has that, she just reminds me of that girl that tries to be cool, but it's just very awkward and somewhat naive.
Or vanilla?
Huh?
Vanilla?
No, I'm not gonna say no. Well, maybe French vanilla.
Tries too hard.
Yeah, she tries too hard. That's really it. She's more vanilla bean.
Okay.
She's got the little black specks in her. I don't know where I'm going with this, but you know, it's just, I think that's really what it is. It's like, you know, look, you're just this goofy girl from Canada, man. Just deal with it.
Yeah, that works.
Yeah. No offense, though. Hell of talent.
Oh, very much so. Tell you what, I'm starting to get it back over here on my side of the board again, so I'm going to go ahead and toss to you for last call.
Real quick, just want to point out, I mentioned Excellence Pro just a minute ago. Guess who showed up out of nowhere at Excellence Pro last night and got a picture with my good friend Babs?
Who dat?
Wonderful Willie Apter.
Hmm.
Yep, Bill Apter showed up. Just showed up out of the blue. It was at Excellence Pro last night.
Nice.
And I may or may not have dropped a hint to Babs and to Edgar that maybe we should have their action on him next.
You need to say that again a little bit more clearly.
Yes, maybe drop the hint to Edgar and Babs that maybe we should have Bill after on one day.
Oh, we've dropped that hint to Bill so many times it's not even funny.
Have we?
Yes, I have.
He doesn't like you.
So? It's not the first time.
He likes me. He doesn't like you.
Well, he can like you all day long. If he likes you enough to come on, he can come on.
Well, that's what we're doing. Don't be mad.
Dude, I'm not mad. I can't be mad.
Hey. Go enjoy your cup of taters.
Okay, look. Daryl B. likes me. Bill Apter likes you. We're even.
You're going to go on your diatribe. We know.
No.
You're going to say something. Yes. Blah, blah, blah. Okay.
No.
Anyway.
Hey, Daryl B. likes me. Bill Apter likes you. That's a wash. I'm good. We're even.
Daryl, who did he ever beat? Exactly. Boom.
Who did Bill Apter ever beat? Boom.
Who did he ever beat? Apparently, he beat a lot of people because that mag's still around.
He's still. In one way or another.
But can we just say that I'm not happy with Cena getting stuck with that North cast? Not happy with that.
You what?
Enzo and Big Cass.
Oh.
Cena's being the this month's crime time. Because remember you had the C Nation, the CTC?
Yeah.
Whatever. Now it's in. Oh. Don't get Cena on them.
Because once you get Cena on
them, they're not going to be good anymore.
And then you're going to. Then not even Bleach will get it off.
Not even Boric Acid will get it off. But, gotta admit, that was funny. The Sonic commercial, when Enzo was like, "What do you got there? Cup of potatoes?" That was funny. Who knows who ever wrote that segment?
Although I do have to sit back and say, I think that Enzo absolutely destroyed it when he went through the presidential diss list.
Oh, yeah. What's funny, though, is, you know, he did that, but about a week ago, if even that much, he, I don't know where he was, but they had, like, puppets or dolls or something of all the presidents. I guess maybe with their wives next to him or whatever. And he did the same shtick. Didn't even look at them. He just, you know, pointed. And his finger landed on everyone. And he did the same thing. But didn't even look at him. Was looking at the thing. But it was named all of them. So.
That's a good memory.
I'm telling you. Yeah, dude, I'm telling you right now. You know, I've heard interviews with Enzo Amore. You know, the guy literally has several notebooks of promos and everything. The guy is—he's
talented,
a genius,
talented.
Huh? Well, that's a foregone conclusion. But like, the guy's a genius as far as he's got great business acumen. He knows how to turn a phrase. You know, this is just from hearing like stuff before he even got into pro wrestling. You know, he managed, at one point was managing one of the most successful Hooters in the country. But, you know, the guy's just, you know, does he have the best wrestling skills? No. He's got the basics. It shows. He's working on it. You know, is he going to be doing, you know, 450s and, you know, different kinds of submissions and all that stuff? No. He's basically there for Big Cass to pick up and throw at people.
Plus, and they did the rocket launcher. I was happy.
Oh, yeah. But when you've got not just the mic skills, but the charisma all together, he cannot say a word and still get over, you know, better than half the roster at times. So, you know, he's you know, one of those rarefied gents. So, I guess if you're going to have anybody with Cena to counteract as far as the popularity of the quote-unquote club or whatever, you know, you want to call them. Although, hashtag beat up John Cena.
That was funny. You gotta admit, that was funny though. No, that was funny with him, and it was so funny because to hear, like, you know, Gallows and Carl Anderson drop some of the stuff, to you know, some of the phrases and stuff, or just little sound bites that they're known for. If you ever listen to back when they had their own talking shop or any of the interviews or anything they've ever done, when Carl Anderson said, you know, yada yada yada, and go home to my hot Asian wife, that's true. Like, he is always dropping that. Was, you know, that's one of his little sound bites, is, you know, he's always talking about his hot Asian wife. And back when he said that, I thought that was hilarious. But, you know, I guess if you're going to have somebody to stick with Cena and try to counteract the popularity of the club, you got to go with the hottest tag team right now on the main roster, and that is a death. So I just pray for the best, hope for the worst.
Are you trying to do the Nick Fury line?
Pray for the worst, hope for the best.
Hope for the best, and do the best you can.
No, what is it, though? It's hope for the best, expect the worst. Something like that. Yeah. I'm done.
Okay.
What you got, big man?
Well, actually, I'm going to go ahead and say this. I'm going to set up for the balance of the night right now, because in less than 1 hour from now, Corner to Corner takes over. Stan, Rob, and Brian with very special guest. He is healthy this week. He is no longer sick. He is Del Wilkes the Patriot. We'll be on Corner to Corner tonight. And, of course, at 11 o'clock p.m. Eastern, brand new edition of the Midnight Black Mass with Reverend Dan Wilson and very possibly Andrew Alexander. Tuesday night, yours truly and Phil Stamper take the reins of Back to Basics, 9:15 Eastern Time, 8:15 p.m. Central Time. The To Be Determined show this coming Wednesday night, 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 Central. And the Shooter's Gallery is back on track for this Thursday night. It's going to be a crazy week. Some things we're going to be covering a lot more in depth later this week on BR, as well as on, on Back to Basics and Shooter's Gallery. The upcoming Shane Shamrock Cup from Maryland Championship Wrestling, MCW. The upcoming Peach State Wrestling Alliance live event in Carrollton, Georgia. And the season 2 finale for Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment slated for this coming Sunday, 1 week from today, the 17th. The Fanatics Arena. It's going to be on fire. Figuratively speaking, not literally. I know Atlanta's had some troubles in the last couple of days. And I'm not there right now. I don't have to clean roadkill off my car. Those who know me know what I mean by that. So I'm going to go ahead and leave it like this. To everybody catching us live all the way up and down the network. And like I said, if you missed it earlier, we did add 3 new affiliates. We are now a part of Streama, Streema.com. We are now a part of Radiotower.com. We are now a part of Radioshaker.com. There are 3 more that I'm waiting to hear back from one way or the other. And the ones that do say yes, I'll be more than happy to put the word out. I do believe I've already made references. We got a couple of the links over on the links page over at BeyondRingside.com. I have been busting my ass trying to get things caught up over there. I really have. The roundtable page is almost caught up. The links page has been changed. The calendar page is up and running. Real quick, before we leave, pro wrestling promoters, MMA promoters, boxing promoters, sporting event promoters, and that includes...
Roller derby.
What?
Roller derby.
Yeah, that includes roller derby. Upcoming live events for pro wrestling specifically... Stamper at WrestleReality.com. Wrestling, mixed martial arts, boxing, roller derby, your upcoming convention, not retail, but your upcoming meet and greets and stuff of that ilk, BeyondRingside@gmail.com. We'll get the calendar up on Wednesday mornings, possibly earlier than that, but our cutoff time is Tuesday, 12:01 a.m. Eastern Time. You can still send it over. If we're able to, we'll get it formatted and put in the list. But like I said, the calendar will be up on .com. The calendar will be on our Facebook sites. So right there, it's that damn simple. For everybody listening, for everybody catching replays on iHeartRadio through YouTube, Daily Motion, all of the above. Actually, we, with our time breaks being screwed up, Daily Motion will be not in the loop this week. But we are going to stay specifically with the YouTube function on the new stuff. I've got new slides coming up a little bit later. So you have to watch it to know what I'm talking about. We're going to go ahead and clear the air. Going to turn it over some music real quick. And for those listening live, check this out. TEKNOAXE, technoaxe.com. Matthew Huffaker, good friend of the family. Great, great instrumentalist. And also has some very good singers come on board with him, too. If you host a radio show, a podcast, if you're wanting to do video games or small movies or things of that ilk, and you're looking for a great source for royalty-free music, check it out. TEKNOAXE.com. Matthew Huffaker at technoax.com. Daryl, always a pleasure to see in the chat room. For everybody who's been coming through the chat over the last few days, you are greatly appreciated. If you hear something that we say, even if it's on the replay, that you'd like to comment on, come over to the chat room, set up a quick ID, make your comment, ask your question. We'd love to be able to, we'd love to know what's on your mind. It's that damn simple. We're going to take it to the Radio Ranch for Mark Mabo Bowman.
Yeah, we're on, what did you say it was? Shaker?
Radio Shaker.
Radio Shaker? Well, you can check out my profile, ladies, over at PantyShaker.com.
He waited a long time for that one.
Well, I didn't want to interrupt you because I know you were trying to get the station up.
I am the Magic City Motor Mouth, Fast Study Lane, saying adios, das vidanya, hasta luego, off Wiedersehen, ciao, sayonara, adieu, arrivederci, farewell, abasinha, Audubon, until we meet again, aloha, means bye-bye, and we thank you for going beyond ringside. Bye for now.